अभी ये नेक्स्ट वीडियो में हम देखेंगे कॉजेज ऑफ बायोडाइवर्सिटी लॉस. ठीक है, तो लेट्स गेट स्टार्टेड. द कॉजेज ऑफ बायोडाइवर्सिटी लॉस आर बिकॉज ऑफ द फोर रीजंस, एंड दिस फोर रीजंस आर नोन एज द एविल क्वारिट इन द सब्रिक्वेट. सो दिस आर द फोर क्वारिट जो कॉज करते हैं बायोडाइवर्सिटी लॉस को. तो वो क्या है, तो लेट्स सी. हैबिटेट लॉस एंड फ्रेगमेंटेशन, ओवर एक्सप्लॉयटेशन, एलियन स्पीशीज इन्वेजन एंड को एक्सटिंक्शंस. राइट, सो फर्स्ट लेट अस सी व्हाट इज हैबिटेट लॉस एंड फ्रेगमेंटेशन. दिस इज द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट कॉज फॉर एक्सटिंक्शन. सेकेंड इज दिस इज द मोस्ट ड्रामेटिक हैबिटेट लॉस कम फ्रॉम ट्रॉपिकल रेन फॉरेस्ट. सो जो सबसे ज़्यादा हैबिटेट लॉस वो आता है वो है ट्रॉपिकल रेन फॉरेस्ट से. सो द ट्रॉपिकल रेन फॉरेस्ट जो पहले टाइम पे कवर करता था 14% ऑफ द अर्थ्स लैंड, बट नाउ इट कवर्स ओनली 6% ऑफ द अर्थ्स लैंड. सो दिस मेनी स्पीशीज आर गेटिंग एक्सटिंक्टेड. राइट, सो मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट कॉज फॉर एक्सटिंक्शन इज हैबिटेट लॉस एंड फ्रेगमेंटेशन. द मोस्ट ड्रामेटिक हैबिटेट लॉस कम्स फ्रॉम द ट्रॉपिकल रेन फॉरेस्ट. द ट्रॉपिकल रेन फॉरेस्ट वंस कवर्ड 14% ऑफ द अर्थ्स लैंड, बट नाउ इट कवर्स ओनली 6% ऑफ द अर्थ्स लैंड. द अमेजोन रेन फॉरेस्ट विच इज नोन एज द लंग ऑफ द प्लैनेट are cut and cleared for cultivating soya beans and beef cattle. It produces 20% of the global oxygen. Do you even realize 20% of the global oxygen was produced by the Amazon rainforest, but we are clearing the or cutting the rainforest for cultivating soya beans and beef cattle, which is harming our global oxygen level, which is 20%, which is constituted 20% of the global oxygen by the Amazon rainforest, and therefore this is known as the lung of the planet because it just supplies us with the oxygen. But they are now cut and cleared for cultivating soya beans and beef cattle. Number two is over exploitation. The need is turning into the greed. Many species extinct in the last 500 years, like steelers, sea cow, passenger pigeon, due to its over-exploitation by humans. And now fishes are endangered. When we consider it as a terms of over-exploitation, then the endangered species is fishes, right? And in the last lecture, we've seen that amphibians is also an endangered species in terms of getting extinct. The alien species invasion, the Nile perch introduced into the Lake Victoria in East Africa, led to the extinction of more than 200 species of chichlid fish in lake, ecologically unique jo hoti hai. So Nile perch was introduced into the Lake Victoria in East Africa, which led to the extinction of more than 200 species of this fish in the lake. The invasive weeds like Parthenium, that is carrot grass, Lantana and water hyacinth caused great environmental damage and posed threat to the native species. The illegal introduction of the African catfishes, that is Clarius gyripinus, for aquaculture posed threat to the indigenous catfishes in the river. So these are the species, alien species invasions which are causing the biodiversity loss. So among that is Nile perch, which was introduced in the Lake of Victoria in Africa, East Africa, that led to extinction of 200 species, more than 200 species of chichlid fishes in the lake, and invasive weeds like Parthenium, carrot grass, lantana, water hyacinth also caused a threat to the native species. They were invasive weeds, and illegal introduction of African catfish, that is Clarius gyripinus, for aquaculture posed threat to the indigenous catfishes in the river. The co-extinctions, like mutualism extinction, that is, if in the case of evolved plant pollinator mutualism, where extinction of one species leads to extinction of other species. Mutualism matlab ek dusre ke bina nahi reh sakte. So even one, if the husband dies, the wife dies. If the mutualists dies, that is, if any of the mutualism में से कोई भी species die कर जाती है, तो उसके साथ जो mutualism में होगा वो भी die कर जाएगा, because without that species, the other species won't be able to survive. So these are known as co-extinctions. The causes of the conservation of the biodiversity. What are the reasons to conserve the biodiversity? Number one is for narrowly utilitarian. So this is because of the obvious use, that is for the benefits of the human. Broadly utilitarian, that is for the general use, that is for the ecosystem we are saving it, or we can say indirectly for the benefit of the human. Number one is narrowly utilitarian, direct hum log sirf human ke bare mein soch rahe, benefits of the human, that is the obvious use, right? The broadly utilitarian is for the general use, that is indirectly it is for the humans only, but in general we are here taking into consideration the ecosystem. And ethical, that is we are conserving the biodiversity for the future generations. So narrowly utilitarian, obvious use, that is direct benefit to the humans, like number of economic benefits like food, fiber, firewood, industrial products, etc. More than 25% drugs derived from the plant, and 25,000 plant species are used as traditional medicine. Increase in bio prospecting, increase rich biodiversity and enormous benefits. So more than 25% drugs was derived from the plant, and 25,000 plant species are used as traditional medicine. And this is because we have to conserve the biodiversity, because it is helping us in drugs and medicines which are traditional, because it is directly used. So more than 25% drugs are derived from this plant, and 25,000 plant species are used as traditional medicine. So this is one of the cause we have to save the biodiversity, that is for direct use of the human. Increase in bio prospecting increases biodiversity and enormous benefits to the humans. So for broadly utilitarian, that is for general use, that is role in ecosystem services that nature provides, that is indirect benefits, for example pollination, pest control, climate moderation, flood control, O2 production. The fast dwelling Amazon forest produced about 20% of the total oxygen in the earth's atmosphere by photosynthesis. The ethical, every species has intrinsic value, that is moral duty to care for well-being and for future generations. When we talk of the biodiversity conservation, it can be done by two ways, in situ conservation and ex situ conservation. We can also preserve it via ex situ conservation, that is herbarium and museum. We talk about in situ conservation, that is on site or in the natural habitat. We have hot spots and protected areas. In protected areas, we have sacred forests, sacred lakes. Number two is biosphere reserves. Number three is national parks. And number four is wildlife sanctuaries. If we talk about ex situ conservation, we can either save it as a whole plant, or we can conserve it as a part of the plant. If we talk about the whole plant, that is botanical garden, or whole animal, that is zoological park, field bank, arboretum, and wildlife safari park. This part of the plant can be conserved as a seed bank, pollen bank, tissue culture, repository, DNA library, cryopreservation where gametes are stored, in vitro fertilization. So this are the ex situ part. Now let us discuss one by one. The in situ protected, in situ means protected in the natural environment or natural habitat. So the hotspots, there are 34 hotspots in the world, out of which India has the 3 hotspots which are rich in biodiversity. Number 1 is Western Ghats in Sri Lanka. Number 2 is Himalaya. Number 3 is Indo-Burma. Sorry, the Indo-Burma is in Sri Lanka. Western Ghats, I have to correct this. The Indo-Burma in Sri Lanka, Western Ghats and Himalaya. The hotspots is also a region of accelerated habitat loss. The hotspot covers less than 2% of the earth's land. It's strict, strict protection of the hotspots reduce the extinction by about 30%, and high degree of endemism, that is species found in particular area, is seen in the hotspot. India has about 14 biosphere reserves, 19 national parks and 448 wildlife sanctuaries. The sacred groves, forest patches, water bodies protected due to religious sanctity. India has about 17,000 sacred groves. Last refuges for large number of rare and threatened plants are in Meghalaya. The sacred groves in situ, Khansi and Janita Hills in Meghalaya. जनीता हिल्स इन मेघालय, अरावली हिल्स इन राजस्थान, वेस्टर्न घाट्स कर्नाटका, महाराष्ट्र इन सरगुजा एंड चंदा एंड बस्तार इन एमपी मध्य प्रदेश. सो द जनीता हिल्स अगेन मेघालय, अरावली हिल्स राजस्थान, वेस्टर्न घाट्स में कर्नाटका, महाराष्ट्र इन सरगुजा, चंदा एंड बस्तार इन एमपी. सैकेड लेक्स इन सीटू पुष्कर राजस्थान एंड खिचियोपेरी इन सिक्किम. द सैकेड प्लांट्स आर एक्स सीटू अगेन फाइकस रिलीजियोसा एंड ओसिमम सैंटम दैट इज तुलसी. द एक्स सीटू आउट ऑफ नेचुरल हैबिटेट प्लेस्ड इन स्पेशल सेटिंग वेयर दे आर प्रोटेक्टेड एंड गिवन स्पेशल केयर दैट इज जूलॉजिकल पार्क, बोटेनिकल गार्डन, IVF, टिश्यू कल्चर एंड क्रायो प्रिजर्वेशन. नाउ यू हैव टू रिमेंबर दिस सैकेड ग्रूव्स की जो प्लांट्स है दैट इज एक्स सीटू, वेर एज द लेक्स ग्रूव्स और फॉरेस्ट आर इन सीटू. सो अगेन जनीता हिल्स मेघालय, अरावली हिल्स राजस्थान, वेस्टर्न घाट्स इज कर्नाटका, महाराष्ट्र इन सरगुजा, चंदा इन विस्तार एरिया इन एमपी, द सैकेड लेक्स पुष्कर इन राजस्थान, खिचियोपेरी इन सिक्किम, फाइकस रिलीजियोसा ओसिमम सैंटम एंड दैट्स इट. द कन्वेंशन ऑफ बायोडाइवर्सिटी. तो नंबर वन द अर्थ समिट, इट वॉज इन रियो डी जनेरियो In 1992, this was for conservation of biodiversity and sustainable utilization of its benefits. The World Summit of Sustainable Development was in 2000 in Johannesburg in South Africa, where 190 countries pledged due to their commitment to achieve a significant reduction in current rate of biodiversity loss at global, regional, local level by 2010. So this was all that was given in NCRT. Now the extra part was, which I think is very important for the NEET, the Red Book Data or Red Data Book and IUCN. Now IUCN, you have many times heard that IUCN in 2004, according to that, this was in past lectures, you can see where IUCN was. And the full form of IUCN, I forgot to mention, that is International Union of Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources. Again, International Union of Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources, IUCN. So this Red Data Book or Red List was initiated by IUCN in 1963. It is also the IUC is now known as WCU, that is World Conservation Union. It is a catalog of taxa at risk of extinction. It has about 8 categories of species. So this is a book which covers the data for which taxa is going to, which is at the risk of extinction, and the 8 categories for the species are given. Some of them are critically endangered species which are likely to be extinct. For example, Sussylvanus, pygmy hillock, barbarous species. So these are the critically endangered species. You have to remember the examples which can be asked. The endangered means which will become extinct if not conserved. For example, red panda, Asiatic wild ass, now restricted to run of Kutch only, the Asiatic wild ass, and lion tailed macaw, that is in forest of South India. Now vulnerable species, so this are this can be endangered if not conserved. For example, antelope, bugbug, black bug, and Indian guerrillo. This and the fourth is threatened species which have combined critically endangered and vulnerable species, all are included in threatened species. So this is the category threatened species, and the subcategories are critically endangered and vulnerable. So you have to remember the examples. Now Sussylvanus, barbarous species, pygmy hillock, this is critically endangered, red panda, Asiatic wild ass, lion-tailed macaw, that is in forest of South India, and the wild ass, the Asiatic wild ass is restricted to the run of Kutch, and vulnerable are antelope, that is black bug, and Indian gorilla, that can be endangered. So here ends the chapter, and this is the part 2 for biodiversity. In next chapter, we will deal with the biotechnology. Thank you.